Hi, I'm going to be in conversation with Shreekumar Varma, poet, playwright, and newspaper columnist from Chennai, who's written a book, very interesting book, called Kipling's Daughter. That happens to be the 18th title of the Anglo-Ink Publishing Company, which has 20 titles to their credit. And this is one of the most fascinating books that I have read in a long time, because it involves a very well-known writer, a Nobel Prize winner, from with roots in India. And I was very, very pleased that I would get an opportunity to speak to the author himself, Mr. Shreekumar Varma, in conversation about his book, Kipling's Daughter. Kipling's Daughter. That's a very nice, interesting name for a book. How did you come upon this name?
Just came from the air, top of the head sort of thing. I'll tell you how it happened. I was talking to Harry and he asked me if I could write something about Anglo-Indians. And I kept saying yes, I wanted to, but there was nothing that came up. So one day I met him at a reception and I was coming back home after that. And suddenly this name came to my mind. So I just had a name. I had no story, I had no background, I had nothing, just this name. And so I started writing, and it is the shortest time I've ever taken to complete a novel, which is 4 months.
That actually is interesting, because your first book came out in 2000.
Yes.
And then 10 years later, 2010, you had Maria's Room.
Yes.
This is almost 10 years to the third book.
But that's right.
4 months to write a book like this seems incredible. And that too, you started with the title before you even thought of the theme. Is that what...
But once the title came in, there were a lot of things that could happen, because essentially the subject was about Anglo-Indians, and Kipling's daughter, if she married an Indian here, would be an Anglo-Indian. So that started the thought process, and that's how it began.
But then when you went on to Wikipedia and you found out that Kipling did in fact have an Indian connection, and for sure we know that he had an Indian connection, but this aspect of his life about whether he had a daughter or not, is it a gray area of controversy that is built on the net?
He was married and he did have three children, an elder daughter who died young, son who died in the war, lost his life in the war, and a daughter who lived to a very ripe old age. So this daughter whom I sort of created was somebody who was born before all of these other births. So this was a mystery area which I created, and the entire follow-up of that character was from the imagination. I mean, there was nothing in the history books. So and I just referred the background of Kipling and drew on that.
And there is absolutely no reference anywhere in his life, after you realized with the research that there is no other reference to anything similar happening in India that he had.
No, nothing. But I thought something similar could have happened and nobody would know about it.
And that's what you built around the end.
Yeah, exactly. Because he became famous after his books were published. He wasn't famous before. So anything could have happened and nobody would have known.
So you're telling me that this whole concept of lighting up a community in terms of its historical significance, the Anglo-Indian, was an idea that was put into you by a friend?
Yes, and, by Harry.
But as it went on, it grew into a plot which you developed?
No, only after this name came up. So first the name and then the story, which is not how it normally happens.
Yes, I'm sure even for you it's not happened before, and for many writers I don't think it happens.
That's
quite
right,
so.
That's true.
So then when the story started evolving, at what point did you decide how you're going to end it, and what would be the length of the... was there some idea that the book would be finally this shape in terms of you know, how many pages it would have and stuff?
Not really. I started out again like the name. the scene in a dilapidated house in the edge of the city, which I have never named, but it is Madras, old Madras. And this dilapidated house and this man sitting there, having lost everything precious in life. That was a scene which started the whole book. And since he was an Anglo-Indian, it stood to reason that Kipling's daughter would continue and end up in some way in his family and his neighborhood.
Looking back, do you think you should have named it, named the city and kind of defined it as Madras? Would it have made a difference now looking back on the story? Because Bombay you have mentioned in the book,
yes,
as the other city. The fact that Madras is not mentioned, would that make a difference to?
Not really, because in certain ways you can sort of guess, second guess the author and know that it is Madras or Chennai now. But in a certain sense, it is best that it remains a mystery, because there is a Kipling house in the book, in the city, and people need not go around looking for Kipling house, since that's part of the imaginative story.
Because you have referred to Trichy quite often towards the end of the book about how they settled in Trichy and all that. So that gave me an idea it had to be Madras. And that's how I guessed that it's set in Madras.
Yes.
But I thought that was a pretty a clever way of building the plot around Madras city. Reuben, the character, was there a reason you chose the name? Especially the protagonist being Reuben, and you know, what was the thinking behind names like Grisham? Are these characters you picked up, you know, out of the blue, or are they because they're currently valid names as well?
Grisham is very easy, because I visualized her as Ma Grissom from the James Hadley Chase book. So Grisham was the nearest to that, when you pronounce Grisham and Grissom. So yeah, that was pretty easy. The others just came up during readings, and you know, that was not much of a problem. Because
so how did the book affect you in terms of when the book was over? How did you find your own thought process affected by the book that you had written? In what way did it affect you as a writer? In a positive way, what were some takeaways, as they say, when you were writing, that built, you know, constructs in your mind about the community?
I did have a lot of Anglo-Indian friends from a very early age. And then Harry is a good friend of mine, so he also sort of has introduced me to certain, the before the reunion, there was another meeting, and I discovered my old a teacher from Good Shepherd Convent, and so I was into that, you know, that area of. So and then I had read a lot of books also, and Kipling, he's got this little circle of, you know, references there, and but there were certain moments that it was very emotional for me. Like there is a moment at the end of it where he talks about a moment when he is, his family goes to a church near the sea,
yes,
and he is left behind for a moment. And I realized later on, when I researched, I realized that church had to do with a lost child, and there was an emotional thing. So I brought that there towards the end, because the end needed an anchor, something heavy to, you know, till then it was between light moments and between mysteries and a thriller and all sorts of kidnapping and all sorts of things. But there needed an anchor and an emotional weight at the end of it, which was what changed me also as a writer, as a person towards the end. That entire story and how this brief to write about an Anglo-Indian family or an Anglo-Indian person turned into something which I could identify with, which was very individual and which, you know, even readers could relate to.
So, Shreekumar, are you saying that this book reflects the pathos of a community that feels lost in India now because of its roots being, you know, slowly being uprooted and taken away. Do you get a feeling at the end of the book that they are struggling with those sense of loss?
Actually, even the Anglo-Indians I have known personally, I haven't found any sort of problem that way. It is only what I have read about them and what people say about them that, you know, bring out this problem of trying to fit into a country where a lot of their own have left and things like that. But once I started the story going, there was this moment when there was a core of tragedy, a core of a loss of identity that had to come in because of this Sindhi British connection. So that became the core of the book as well. And that sense of identity, that realization that you are not whom you thought you were, which is true in the case of anybody. Like there is a novel, Rabindranath Tagore has written a novel called Gora, in which he is staunchly anti the British. And then he realizes that he is also from that stock, which is a traumatic experience. That core of tragedy realization, and then coming to terms with that, because it's not a criminal sort of situation. It is something that you have stepped into, that identity that you have stepped from one identity into another. That is all. So that is why towards the end of the book there is this funeral procession as they're going to meet that lady, Grisham, Mrs. Grisham. And in that, there is a conversation about how you have to understand. There are so many things in society that
I recall those words, understand and accept. Yes.
So you may not relate to something, but you can understand it, and then the way is easier. So when an Anglo-Indian or an Indian try to bridge that gap between each other, then there is no problem.
I remember that. I very clearly remember where I read that. It says, that's what makes a society, she said, like a school teacher. Understand and accept, even if you're not a part of it.
That's true.
So that we are, even if you're not a part of it, is where I got this feeling that there is a sense of loss, that they're neither there nor here. And you've used the word half caste, which applies to many such, you know, many such ethnic races all over the world.
Which is something I have said even during the launch of the book, that half caste in the sense, everybody is half caste. You're part of your mother and your father. So it doesn't really relate to what the father was and what the mother was, but you are a mixed of mixed blood. Everybody is mixed blood. So when you realize that in yourself, then you can understand that in anybody else.
Absolutely.
So this purity of the blood need not necessarily be a virtue or a reason to belong, which is why I have got these Parsi couple, the Parsi couple, and this part of the Rubens, this part of the family is a Sindhi family. So all of them have been displaced at one time or the other, and all are trying to belong. And at one point of time, you realize that everybody is part of the same scenario, the same ground, the same under the same sky.
And I've often felt that India is perhaps the only place in the world where within a country, you have so many castes, as we call them, or you know, denominations of people living harmoniously with each other, and also perhaps finding their roots in the process in different ways. Here you use the word celebrate rather than, you know, feel guilty. You say one should celebrate one's roots and all that. So my question was that I have read your earlier book, Maria's Room, and I found that there also there was a mystique of a lot more drama attached to the whole book, and which really made it fascinating. And there I think you introduced a foreigner as well in that book, who comes and plays a key role in the...
Yes, Marcel Dino. He's a French artist.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right. So I realized that it goes beyond just, you know, defining a new character. You actually have to think through many, many layers of each character and the caste they represent. In this, what was the biggest challenge in writing this book in terms of creating an identity for the Anglo-Indians? What was the toughest part in defining those characters? Was it the naming of the character? Was it the way you described them physically? What really was a challenge to bring out the Anglo-Indian, essence of Anglo-Indian characters?
More than the essence of the Anglo-Indian character itself, it's the essence of the past where they belong and where they come from. So going into that, reaching into that space, and like you said, in India, you have so many people coming together and you can see, feel their roots. Not like another place where every culture is brought in and it becomes a melting pot, which means you can't identify individually the tomatoes and the potatoes and the carrots and the rest of the vegetables, because they're all mixed and you just see the one big thick syrup. Here, you can identify each individual gene, character, and tone, rhythm of life, all that you can identify, and still they're part of the same gang, as it were. So that is what I was looking at, finally. And that's where I reached as well. In some of these books, I do not have an agenda. I do not write down a theme and then start working. Even here, it was like that. It just, the story just took me along. Only when it reached the point of the identification of the girl, the Anglo-Indian girl who realizes that she is part of a mixed union, mixed race union. That's when this, the core, when I realized the core, that's when I had to work back and then do all my rewriting and things like that. So till then it was just straight stuff, and there was a bit of an element of a thriller to it. There was this kidnapping, there was this person being taken away. So all those elements which are my favorites, having been brought up on Agatha Christie and the rest, that was all there. But then having reached this point, I realized that there is a entirely vastly human thing that I am going towards, and to recreate that moment in the story, that was when I began to work back, and that's where I stopped and the novel started taking a new turn.
So how does the Kipling family look at this book if they had a chance to read it? How do you think they would receive this book? Someone in the Kipling family, perhaps now in England.
For one thing, the book that mentions this is no longer in existence. And in the entire book, nobody can find out who's the author. So that is one escape valve I have taken already. The other thing is, everybody else mentions this, but there is nothing about Kipling himself suggesting it or anybody from there. I have mentioned a few sources in the about the in all along the book. But nowhere is it conclusively said. And at the beginning of the book, I have said that I would like to thank people for... I mean, this book is a work of fiction, and I would like to thank anybody who thinks otherwise.
Okay.
So that's another...
That's another way of
telling them that it's fantasy. Because if Kipling's readers cannot take fantasy, then I don't know who will.
So now that you look back, the choice of the word Kipling itself was has a story behind it, because he himself wrote stories. You wrote a story on his story, and one doesn't know whether this is fact or fiction.
No, the basic thing is that he is so famous, he was all around the world, he was a Nobel Prize winner, and there is a story which nobody realizes. Least of all a person who's struggling with his own self and coming to terms with an enormous fact of his parenthood and his origins. So that interested me a lot. An unknown person becoming part of a huge, famous, world, universe.
Thank you so much for giving us a book. Let's look forward to the next one.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.